No, Paul's is, yeah, the came off the stand.
Yeah, I guess yes. It did. I guess he moved it. I don't know. I just wondered how it got over there.
Uh-huh.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Is there a particular chair you want me sitting in? To the altar? Okay. All right. Who else is up there? Okay. That it? Well then, with all due respect, am I being dismissed the first time? And if you're going to be where there, I'll be there. That way we'll... Oh, you do have... You're right. Okay, you win. Okay. 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 In the interest of symmetry, Dad, I will. He's going to get tired of my being special.
Sit by John.
Yeah, you can. You.
have grilled that will be open.
Christ is risen indeed.
Darkness has been vanquished.
The brilliant light of hope has come.
Come, let us worship and celebrate the good news.
Alleluia. Christ is risen. Amen.
Come on, look at you. Oh my goodness. catch my breath. They're just so beautiful. And look how many are up here. And it's so glad to see all of you in our church together on Easter Sunday morning. You know, last week we talked about how it was kind of a grim week, wasn't it, with Holy Week? But what I told you, Sunday was coming, didn't I? And what's today? Easter. You can say it louder than that. Easter Sunday. That is right. And I am so glad that you are here. Well, today we're going to talk about an Easter surprise. Easter surprise. Wonder what they're talking about. Well, did you know it isn't about finding something that wasn't expected? It's about not finding what was expected. I'm going to share with you about an Easter surprise. On the Sunday after Jesus was crucified, Mary Magdalene and another woman named Mary went to visit the tomb where Jesus had been buried. Does anybody know what happened when they got there? What happened? They found Jesus wasn't there, was he? No, he wasn't. The stone, what happened with the stone, do you know? It was gone. It was rolled away, right? And there was an angel sitting there. And the two women were really, really shocked. In fact, they were a little afraid. Now, here's where you guys get to be a part of the children's message this morning. And we'll see if the congregation listens to what they should do here in a little bit, okay? Every time you hear me say, Jesus, I want you guys to say, and I want you to say it loud, He is risen. Can you do that? Well, let's practice. Jesus.
He is risen.
Oh, come on. You guys are louder than that. I know. We'll try one more time. Jesus.
He is risen.
Perfect. Okay. Now listen to the story, and every time I say it. All right. All right. Do not be afraid, the angel said to them. I know you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said he would. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. The two Marys looked in awe, and they saw that the tomb was empty. And they hurried away. They were so surprised. They were afraid, though. But they were filled with joy as they ran to tell the disciples they met Jesus. They ran to him and grabbed him and worshiped him. Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee and they will see me there. Now, that is what I call a real Easter surprise. They went to see Jesus. Let's try that again. They went to see Jesus.
He is risen.
Okay, in the tomb, but he was not there. He was risen. And that's why when we see our friends, such as the people in the congregation on Easter Sunday, we greet them by saying, He is risen. And our friends reply, He is risen indeed. So, this morning, I want to thank you guys for helping us. You know, this has been a good sermon for all of you as well. We're going to say a prayer, and I need you to listen really closely, even during the prayer. All right, let's bow our heads. Dear God, we thank you for the glorious celebration of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. Okay, let's listen again. Okay, I'll just read the prayer, and then you guys listen for the Lord Jesus, okay? Dear God, we thank you for your glorious celebration of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. We are not surprised that the tomb was empty. He has risen just as he said he would. In his name we pray. Amen. Now, I want you all to say, He is risen, and see if anybody else says anything back to you. Okay, stand up. That way everybody can see how pretty you look this morning. Now turn to the congregation and say, He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
They were listening, weren't they? All right. Okay, well, everybody was a good student this morning. And so, before you go back to your seats, you get to take a bag. And Miss Beth and Miss Mary Jane packed bags for you with surprises in them, okay? You can take one, and you guys have a great day with your family, and enjoy, honey, Easter eggs and all the fun stuff, okay? See you next time.
Good morning, church. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
All right, everybody's got that down. That's the story of reading on Easter that's been for centuries and centuries. And we join the host of witnesses throughout the ages to celebrate, to give God praise for what God has done in Jesus Christ in giving us a victory over sin and death. And we're here to celebrate. Isn't that great? We're back together for the first time in 2 years on Easter. So let's give God a hand. This is so tremendous. You know, it's been such a long year, hasn't it? And you've done so great. You have adjusted and adapted, and the church didn't miss a beat. We didn't miss one Sunday through the whole pandemic. And that's thanks to you. So many work behind the scenes, and so many of them are doing that this morning, such as Jim Perry up in the sound booth, and Ralph's down here on the PowerPoint projector. He puts all these beautiful slides together, takes hours and hours. Ralph worked overtime. He ran the sound every day this week at Gazebo, as we have our Holy Week services. So Ralph is a tremendous servant. Chuck Daly's up there. Lisa Bailey's running our Facebook feed this morning. And so that's very, very important. We're thankful for that. These beautiful flowers, Amy Perry, and I think Carolyn Rader, Mayor Rader also helped put this together. We have people, Mo and Brett have worked extra hard to get the ushers, extra ushers than we did. We tried to provide overflow in the sanctuary because we only see so many in here. Chad Smith worked extra hours getting all these chairs set up and arranged. And Paula not put out some of the beautiful decorations. And so it's been really a group effort. And let's just say thank you to all of those servants who have worked so hard for us. Shoulder injury. know for sure that we have eternal life, and we can know for sure that there is meaning and purpose to life, that we are, all of our blessings, we know who to thank for them. We also know who to go to for help in time of need, and we're thankful that we have not just a risen Jesus, but an ever-present Jesus who says, I am with you always. So thank you, O God, for being with us through this tough year. Thank you, O God, for how you have helped us to persevere, how you've helped us to heal, how you've helped us to find hope when there are so many reasons to despair. We're thankful that we can gather here today in this church and virtually with people around the world to join billions around the world to give you praise for that great victory that makes all the difference in our lives. And so we can pray with confidence for those who are grieving today to know that this loss is only temporary, and may the Cummings family find your peace, and others who are grieving today. We also want to lift up to you for your healing help and grace and strength to be with John Jones and to be with the Currys, to be with Joyce as she goes through surgery, to be with Brett and others that we name in our hearts that are struggling, suffering, trying to just make it one more day. You know, many are struggling economically. They're struggling spiritually. They're struggling emotionally and socially. Lord, enter in to their suffering and give them the grace that's more than sufficient. We thank you that we can pray in the mighty name of the risen Savior who cares for us like no other. We lift up all of our concerns and praises in his name, and we pray together as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power. get a communion cup, we will have communion at the end of the service. Where's my ushers here? Somewhere. Raise your hand and Greta will get you a communion cup. Somehow you slip in here without a communion cup. Just raise your hand right now and you'll get that. Mass that you received, we have an opportunity, it's going to be Saturday, not Wednesday, to go to the Catholic Church in Ravenswood and see how they bless that community by serving a free meal every week to anybody in the community, whether they're needy financially or they're needy emotionally and socially, they are doing that. And there's several in this congregation who feel like we can do that. We have so much money that's been given to our food ministry that we think we can expand this to bless more people in different ways to bring food to people, even a hot meal. So if you're interested in just wanting to observe and see how they do that, learn how they do that, they've got more volunteers than they need. Great problem to have.
Bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there,
rise from the dead. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Always love reading that scripture. It's like John and Peter in a race together, outdo each other, and to get to the tomb. John, who wrote the gospel, always makes mention he was the first one to get there and believe. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the good news that has echoed for 2,000 years to our ears and hearts today. May that good news and joy and power and love fill our hearts so that they overflow with gladness, overflow with grace, overflow with truth, overflow with your love, and yes, the Holy Spirit, your very presence with us. Teach us. Help us, O Lord, not only to hear it, but to do your word. In the name of the one who was the word that became flesh and dwelt among us. Amen. It is a joy to gather together here on this Easter Sunday. More of us than in over a year in this church. And so it's a great joy. But when you think about it, it's a great joy that we also get to join one-third of the world's population today, yes, one-third of the world's population praising God for Jesus Christ's resurrection. That's 2.3 billion people around the world today saying, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, hallelujah. The Christian church, if you think about it, is by far the largest organization on earth. The church is bigger than China. All of the people in China, the church is bigger than that. The church is bigger than China, the United States, and all of Europe combined. Wow! It's amazing. Do you realize you're a part of the greatest movement ever in history? We're a part of that. That ought to thrill your heart this morning. Nothing else to know that you're a part of the greatest movement God in history, the most important event of history. So how did it all happen? How did Christianity spread so far and so fast, especially when Jesus had no money, no political power or armies, no famous name, no education, he didn't write any books, he didn't have technology, as Mike alluded to, we're reaching people around the world with our technology. He didn't have that. He didn't have any transportation. And he did it all in 3 years. He only preached for 3 years. How did it all happen? There's no other movement in the history of the world that can compare to that when his leader only was like Jesus with all those things lacking and only did it. And then it's even more amazing when you think that Jesus was a convicted criminal. And he died a criminal's death on a cross. And when he was dying on Good Friday, how many people were there? How many followers did Jesus have? About a dozen. That's about all that was there. That's about all the people who were committed enough to Jesus to stick with him at the cross. You know, they're families today. We lifted up the Cummings family today, didn't we? I bet the Cummings family has more people who surrounded Wanda as she was dying than Jesus had when he was dying. There are more families in Ripley had more people who will surround their loved ones than Jesus had when he died. So how do you go from a dozen people to billions of people over 2,000 years? I mean, it's impossible, isn't it? There's nothing else like it. How do you explain Christianity? deserted him, save one child. Fearful people don't make for a worldwide movement, do they? Especially against great opposition. There's only one answer. There's only one answer. Resurrection. The resurrection is the only way to explain Easter. When God sent his son, Jesus, to reveal who he was, to demonstrate his love by dying on the cross and rising again, that changed everything. All of history changed. It's the most significant event in all of time. Because of Jesus and his resurrection, all of history split in two. Everything that happened before Jesus, B.C. Everything that's happened since Jesus, A.D. Which means in the year of our Lord, A.D. It's the Latin. This is the fascinating thing. I love this because even the atheists have to confess the significance of Jesus Christ every time they look at the calendar. Every time they write down their birth date. Why? Or how? Because their birthday that year is all the years since Jesus lived. It's 2021 since Jesus. And everybody acknowledges Jesus who writes down the date. That's why following Jesus is the most important thing that you can do. It's the greatest thing you can do with your life. Because he still changes the world through people today who know him and follow him. It's the best decision that you can make. It's the greatest priority that you can have in your life. To commit to him and follow him. Because there's no one else in history that was like him. You think about it. There's not a religious leader who's ever lived who loves you like Jesus loves you. So much that he or she was willing to die for your sins as if they could. And having authority to forgive your sins as if they could. Jesus' resurrection, it proves not only his love and forgiveness, but his authority over sin. Not one of these other religious leaders has risen from the dead, have they? Not one. You want to go visit their tombs? You can. You can go around the world and look at all of the tombs of the great religious leaders of the world, and their bodies are still there. You go to Jerusalem, and some of us did a couple of years ago, and you see an empty tomb. It was emptied after 3 days, and nobody could find the body. But those who love Jesus got to see him and experience him. Do you want to know what God is really like? Get to know Jesus. Get to know Jesus, and you'll discover who God really is. But on that first Easter, even today, so many are going to miss Easter, miss the resurrection, because they didn't know Jesus. They knew about him. Today, many people know about Jesus, but they're missing the power of the resurrection because they don't know him personally. When you think about it, many people believed in Jesus. He had thousands of people who believed in him, but they so quickly deserted him on Good Friday, and they joined the mob crying out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Today, most people in America believe in Jesus. Most of them say, but that has little to change your life or their lives. You see, believing costs you nothing. And that's why I think John chapter 3:16, you see it at ball games, t-shirts, wherever you go. John 3:16 is probably the most popular verse in all of the Bible. God so loved the world. country would be the most loving and forgiving country in the world. But it's not. We know that. All we've got to do is turn on the news and see how divided we are, how much hate there is today, and how much fighting is going on between people. The real question is not do you believe, but do you follow Jesus? Do you follow him? See, Jesus asks for much more than belief, because belief won't change your life. He asks us to follow him. Perhaps the most unpopular verse in the Bible is Luke 9:23. If anyone will come after me, they must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. You know, if I had a t-shirt company and I was trying to make it by selling t-shirts with that verse on it, I'd go broke. People love John 3:16. They don't wear Luke 9:23. You see, Christianity, it didn't take off because of believers. It conquered the world through followers. And what was the last word that Jesus gave his disciples before he ascended into heaven? It's the first priority of the church is to get up and go and make disciples in all the world and teaching them to obey everything that he taught. That's what changes the world. Not believing, but following Jesus. And that can only happen when we follow him to each other. Where is Jesus today? Well, he's right here. Because you see, the church is the body of Christ. If we are to follow him, we have to follow him here together. Because Jesus died and rose again, not just to get us to heaven. He came to bring in the kingdom. He came to bring a loving community together. He came to make you and me family together forevermore. So if we're going to be followers, we got to be here all the time, as much as we can, to support each other and teach each other. We've got to learn from more experienced disciples or followers of Christ so that we can learn how to do this, how to follow Jesus, how to know him. And that's what's been happening for 2,000 years. That's what the disciples did. To be a disciple means to be a follower, and disciples make disciples. If you're not mentoring somebody right now, you've got two choices. You can either start mentoring somebody because you've been a follower of Christ for a long time, or you can start being an apprentice to somebody. You'll need to start learning. But that's the process that Jesus gave us, to be a follower, not just a believer. Because you see, it's in following him that we get to know him. You think about it. When those disciples first were called by Jesus, they were fishing. Remember, they had their fishing nets. And Jesus says, come, follow me. And they dropped their nets and followed him at the very beginning. How well did they know him at that point? Not very well. Now, they already believed in him because of what John the Baptist had taught. So they had believed, and then Jesus asked them to follow, and it's only when they start following that they get to know him. So how do you know that you know him? How do you know? Could you tell somebody today? Well, you'll know because it changed your life. You're never the same. You know because you start hearing his voice inside speaking to you. You know because he gives you a love that you didn't have before. A love for those who even don't love you in return. That's a sign that he's there. You have power and purpose and direction. The question this morning, do you really know him? It's not just do you believe and do you follow. Do you know him? Really know him as your most intimate friend in your life. If you come today, you can't necessary to become the transformed people who transform the world, like they did in his day. It's the reason that nobody was following Jesus anymore on Easter. Notice that nobody was there at the tomb on Easter morning except Mary, Magdalene, and a few other women. Mary, we see, followed Jesus all the way, didn't she? She was at the cross when he died. And here she is on Easter morning at the tomb, not to see a risen Jesus. She didn't expect him to be alive and risen from the dead. They were just thinking maybe at the end of time of the general resurrection. She didn't expect it on Easter morning. Why is she there? Because she loves Jesus. She's there to take care of his body and make sure he had a proper burial. If you remember on Good Friday when they took him down from the cross, the Sabbath was about to start, and they had to hurry up and get him into a tomb, but they didn't have time to do a proper burial. She's there because she loves him. Why does Mary get up and go and none of the other disciples do? One word, love. Love is the reason. Love is what transforms the world. Love is what transforms your life. And nobody loves you like Jesus. That's the joy of this morning. The disciples, what were the disciples most concerned about? Not Jesus. Their own heads, right? They're hiding. They're worried about protecting themselves from being arrested and maybe executed like Jesus. They're more about themselves, loving themselves, than they are about loving Jesus. But not Mary. Mary loved Jesus because she was first loved by him. And she, her life was saved by him. She was delivered from 7 demons, it says. Now, I don't know what that's like. I don't know if any of you know what it's like to be delivered from 7 demons. And thankfully, I don't have to know that. I've never experienced that. But if you have, if you've been delivered from this dark, evil oppression, you pretty much know that person in your life, don't you? And that's what Mary did. She committed her life for what Jesus did for her. She loved him. She wasn't just thankful. She loved him. You'll do anything for true love, won't you? People will do anything. You're searching for love all the time, and sometimes you're searching for love in all the wrong places. But we need that love, and there is no greater love than Jesus' love for you. It's unconditional, it's unending, and it's unfailing. Now, there's nothing you have to do. Nothing you have to do. You don't have to be good enough or do so many good works to get Jesus to love you. He already loves you. And nothing you need to do to get him to love you. And here's the other great thing. There's nothing you can do to stop him. You can't be bad enough to stop him. You can ignore him. You can reject him. You can even nail him to the tree like you did on Good Friday. He just keeps coming back from the dead to love you and to love everybody in this world. Even before you believe and you follow and you know him, he loves you. And if you know him, you love him in return. And that's why Mary was the first one to experience Easter. Because she loved him. And that's what love does. Love gets up and goes to the ones you love, even if that means a great risk. And that was a great risk to Mary, because she could be arrested. She could be executed. And we see that they continue to do that to Christians. The Apostle Paul was the chief persecutor and executor. The disciples weren't willing to do that. They were afraid and more self-centered than Jesus-centered. And if you make your life Jesus-centered, you cannot be any more loving than when you were Jesus-centered. money and your talent to him, you won't witness him to other people if you don't love him. Because you know, you'll do anything for those you love, for your children, or your grandchildren, or your spouse. You sacrifice and stay close to the ones you love. The disciples believed and followed Jesus, and they saw many miracles. But they had to come to fully love him ahead of themselves. But if you experience that love, and you can this morning, if you experience that love, then it will change you, and you will never, never be the same. It changed Mary. It changed that persecutor of the church, Paul. And he was the one who was able to write the greatest love poem in the world. The love chapter in 1 Corinthians 13. He wrote that. It's been read at virtually at most weddings for 2,000 years. And in that chapter he says, faith is good. Hope is good. But the greatest of these is love. A love that you can't produce, I can't produce, you can only receive it. And Jesus is more than willing to give it to you today if you'll receive him into your heart and life. You see, the disciples had a love problem, didn't they? They didn't have an ego problem, they had a love problem. And so that's why Jesus told them on his very last night, the last supper, he says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another in the same way I have loved you. You too must love one another. And as you know, this was no ordinary love. This was the love that stooped down and washed the disciples' feet. This is the love that went to the cross and was nailed to the cross. And Jesus went on to say, if you love me, then you'll do everything that I command. And that's what Paul was talking about in Ephesians chapter 5 that Mike read for us today. Paul was saying, wake up, church! Wake up to the love and grace that are before you today. Wake up, church! To the power and the possibilities that are before you today. Get up. Get up and make the most of the opportunities before you. For these days are short and they are dark. God is giving you and me opportunities every day. Even the rest of this day, tomorrow, this week. Opportunities to make a difference. To live and love just like Jesus did. To transform your home, your school, your workplace, and community. But it'll never happen until we come to him and are transformed by the Holy Spirit. That's what happened to Mary. Mary was delivered and transformed from the inside out. And it wasn't until the disciples experienced the foot washing and experienced the crucifixion that they were ready, they were broken and ready to open their lives to the Holy Spirit. Call it conversion, call it being born again, but no one can love like Jesus without transforming, without the transforming love of the Holy Spirit. It's that love that burst out of the tomb on Easter Sunday and exploded into the world, and the shock waves of that resurrection reverberate today. That brings us here to worship. It comes when you believe, you follow, you know, and then love Jesus in the power of his Holy Spirit. So on that Easter Sunday, Mary went and told the disciples, he's risen, he's alive. And they got up to the upper room and they waited, and there Jesus appeared to them. And what was the first thing Jesus did on that Easter Sunday? He gave them the Holy Spirit. You see, you can't love like that without the Holy Spirit. Mary had the Spirit, didn't she? Because the Spirit Spirit of Jesus cast out the demons. The Spirit of Jesus replaced the spirit of the demons and filled her. And so we need to wake up to the Spirit of Jesus. Wake up to the opportunities. And when you do, Paul says, Christ will shine on you, giving you the same love and power that changed history and will make all the difference today. Like Mary, you got to get up and go. The risen Jesus is here, right now, to bless you beyond imagination with his love and his power. Do you believe that Jesus died and rose for you? Do you believe that? Well, that's great. But it won't change your life. The life of Jesus is so much more. It's being with Jesus, isn't it? It's following Jesus. Do you want to be with Jesus? Do you want to be with him wherever he goes? Wherever he stays? Well, what do you got to do? You got to get up and what?
Go.
Say it with me. You got to get up and
go.
Join Jesus. Join other followers in following him. Do you want to know Jesus and his love? You got to get up and what?
Go.
Go. Yeah, you got to go. You got to get up and spend time with him in the mornings. Pray. Read the scriptures. Do you want to love Jesus? Then you got to get up and
go.
To make new followers in his name. And if you'll wake up and get up and go, you'll experience the light of his love, the light of the risen Jesus shining on you to bring God's love and grace wherever you go. But you gotta get up and
go.
Now we can do better than that. Let's try one more time. Let's let Jesus know we really mean it. You got to get up and
go.
I think you might have heard that. Okay. Well, let's get up and see, because he got up and went on that Easter Sunday up from the grave, he arose, and then we'll receive the Holy Spirit. Gracious God, forgive us whenever we want an easy path. God is merciful. God is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Feel the healing, loving power of God in your lives, for it is given to you through Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we remember Jesus Christ and what he did for us on the night that he gave himself up for us. And he took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke the bread, and he said, "Take and eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said, "Take and drink, for this is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of God's mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we pray that the bread and the cup will be for us the very body and blood of Christ, forgiving us, cleansing us, and empowering us so that we can be the body of Christ in the world today. Amen. Take your wafer and remember that this is the body of Christ broken for you. Oh. You'll take your cup. This is the cup of blessing. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the broken bread that makes us one body. Thank you for the cup of salvation that renews our souls. Help us, O God, to be the resurrection people, ready to go beyond belief, to following, knowing, loving, and obeying everything you've told us. To experience that love, and to give that love, and to give you the glory as we bless others in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's say it one more time and sing that final verse. Let's rise and go for Jesus who rose for us. Blessed and keep.